guys. Very nice. Orchestra is looking robust as well, a little bigger than usual. Welcome back, especially to the... All right, well, welcome. We're so glad you're joining us this morning or this evening, wherever you are. And we're so grateful that we have our music and that we're gathering, and that out of all the stuff that we've been going through, it really does feel like just life is coming back, and we're grateful for that. So today, this truly is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning.
Yes, and hello, visitors and church family. Yes, we are just so happy to have you here and so happy to have the choir here and the full orchestra. It's such a special day. So thank you for being here. I want to encourage you, if you are standing on the word of God for a healing or a miracle in your life, to keep your eyes focused on Jesus and not on your symptoms. Peter miraculously walked on water when he was looking at Jesus, but the Bible said that he felt and he saw the waves. So I think, you know, when you focus on what you're feeling or what you're seeing, it spooked him and he began to sink. But I love that it said he cried out to Jesus. He said, "Jesus, save me." And I just imagine him locking eyes with Jesus. And it says he reached out and caught him and he was saved. Jesus will do the same thing for you, my friend. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Keep your eyes on him. You are loved.
Amen. Lord, we thank you so much for gathering us in this way, whether we're in the house or gathered online or through television. I just pray your Holy Spirit does something special for all of those who are participating in this event. We pray, God, that you would make us disciples, that you would encourage us today, teach us, help us grow, and we pray it all in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Turn to the person next to you and say, "God loves you, and so do I."
This is my song.
inspiration for the message, James 3, 2, and 9 through 12. We all stumble in many ways. Anyone who is never at fault in what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. With the tongue, we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praising and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives? Or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. Amen.
My eyes.
Thank you for joining us on Hour of Power today. We hope you found incredible hope and inspiration from this program. As the world gradually comes back to life after more than a year of being cocooned in quarantine, a fresh start is beckoning us to embrace a vibrant future, to dream big, and to look with anticipation to the great things the Lord wants to accomplish through us on the earth.
As always, this is the cry of our hearts here at Hour of Power. We've been humbled as God has sustained us through what was surely the most challenging season in recent history. And now we're ready to forge ahead even with greater gusto.
For the past 5 decades, whether on mountaintops or in valleys, your support and prayers have loved us back to life. And today, we're ready to share Jesus' good news with millions more. However, we need your help to make it happen in the midst of our summer slump.
We're trusting the Lord to uphold us so we can take the transforming power of the gospel to new generations. And we're joyfully giving thanks for your role in our story. In fact, you are the heart behind our July special offers.
Call, write, or go online to request our beautiful butterfly sun catcher. Featuring an antique copper metal frame, your sun catcher is suspended from a decorative chain and comes with a suction cup for easy display. A hand-painted finish creates a gleaming stained glass effect and will be a vibrant addition to your window or patio. We're asking for your gift of $25 or more. For your generous gift of $40 or more, we'll send you the butterfly sun catcher and the Today I Choose Joy canvas banner and prayer card. Perfect for display in your home or office, this decorative banner is a meaningful reminder to live each day with joy, and the matching frameable card provides a comforting prayer of encouragement. Call, write, or go online to request the butterfly sun catcher for your gift of $25 or more, or for your gift of $40 or more, we'll include the Today I Choose Joy canvas banner and prayer card.
Hannah and I are incredibly grateful for the way you uphold us. Your financial support provides the foundation we need to continue reaching friends all around the world. So thank you. We're praying for you. And remember, as always, God loves you, and so do we.
Desiree Siegfried is a television personality, fashion designer, podcast host, and author. She first appeared on The Bachelor in 2013, and when the opportunity arose for her to star as The Bachelorette later that year, she thought it would lead her to the life she'd always dreamed of. She chronicles the twists and turns of the journey in her new book, The Road to Roses: Heartbreak, Hope, and Finding Strength When Life Doesn't Go as Planned. In it, she reveals how surrendering to God finally led her to the abundant life she'd been wanting. Please welcome Desiree Siegfried.
Desiree, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Yes, thank you for having me.
So for those who maybe don't know your story, tell us a little bit about your journey in this show and your faith and all of those conflicts and things that you have felt. And
yeah, I mean, I grew up with a great foundation of faith, but my journey onto the show really was just, it was all God. I mean, I share about it in my book, but it was just one of those things where I was in a time of life where I didn't know where else to turn. I was seeking God wholeheartedly, but I literally had no idea what was next for me. And then out of nowhere, the doors started to open, and I just walked faithfully through each door, and here I am. And I met my husband, have 2 kids, and, you know, living a life I never really thought possible.
So tell us that story. For those who have not seen the show, tell us about the show itself, and I'd love to hear, too, how that worked out with you, you know, and your husband and everything like that.
Yeah, so I mean, I first appeared on The Bachelor. This is about 8 years ago in 2013, and it didn't work out for me on The Bachelor, but I was lucky enough to continue on to The Bachelorette, and that is where, you know, I had some struggles, mm-hmm. going back to old patterns. But I ultimately met my husband, and it's been the best thing best thing ever.
That's great. So is your husband the man you met on the show, or did you meet your husband
yes.
later? Awesome. Okay.
So I met, yeah. So I met Chris on the show.
Awesome.
It's very interesting.
That'd be like my first question is, you know, when I think of just full disclosure, I've not seen the show,
sure.
but I know a lot of people who love a show. It's one of the biggest shows in America, but I have like mixed feelings about it, you know, because I think about, you know, it feels like, I don't know. I often wonder, is it real? Are they really? But it obviously was real for you and your husband.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, going on to the first time, I was such a skeptic. I mean, mm-hmm. I also was like, what am I doing? Like dating a guy who's also dating multiple women. But, you know, it worked because you have no distractions. And so you are only focusing on the relationship at hand, and you're not allowing like outside noise to affect your opinions. And so it truly works. I mean, it's a short amount of time, but if you're intentional with the time that you have, and if you're actually like seeking the best decision for you and what God wants for you, then it totally works.
Did you ever feel as the Bachelorette? So I get it mixed up sometimes. The Bachelorette is, they're fighting for you that time, right? It's a bunch of dudes that want to marry you. That's so much better, I feel like, for you as in a position like, you're leaving a winner no matter what. You get to choose from this array of guys. And it has to be fun having a bunch of men compete over you.
It's fun, but you ultimately don't want that many guys. You truly want just one person to give your whole heart to. And so that's where it's a struggle. And it was a little harder for me because I mean, it's just a different situation. I'm more of an introvert, and I really love like one-on-one time in a relationship. And so that made it very difficult. I think that being on the show, and then I also talk about the aftermath of the show, like having so many opinions and pressures put on you as you're trying to navigate a new relationship is very difficult. Mm-hmm. And I had to learn and struggle through allowing other people's words to define my worth and really just seek, you know, God's worth.
Yeah.
And who I am in Christ. And so that's truly like a lesson learned throughout the whole journey.
Yeah, absolutely. What about like your faith and going through a huge TV show that sometimes is very sexualized and has like a lot of, you know, all of these things that do kind of conflict with your values. And yet I know like you love the Lord with all your heart and like you really saw this. I mean, for you, it was really an opportunity, wasn't it, in a way? Tell me about how all that worked together.
I mean, I was never going to compromise my faith in terms of the show. And luckily, when I went on, The Bachelor was also a devout Christian. So that made that part like much easier.
Mm-hmm.
And then so when I was going to go on to The Bachelorette, like faith was always very important. And I had those conversations with all of the men. Ultimately, I didn't need to be on the show. I didn't really want to be. It was one of those things that I prayed about it. And I was like, you know, God, if this is the door that you have for me, then I will use this door to glorify you. And
absolutely. Yeah.
And you know, and I think if we keep our eyes on him, things just work out. Like I didn't strive for this. I didn't want this. And that's ultimately, excuse me, why they chose me.
Sure.
And honestly, it's just it's all a part of God's plan.
Awesome. When I think about the show too, I wonder if a really positive side of it, I feel like we're really in the midst of hookup culture where a lot of people are about, you know, shallow relationships and hooking up. But actually the intent, even though I think the show probably could be that way sometimes, I think that the intent of the show is for the two people to actually get married, right? Don't you, it's like they want an engagement at the end. So to me, I think the fact that it is really nice that you're encouraging people to make a real commitment to each other. I feel like a lot of people today are really scared of commitment. There've been so many bad marriages that it's caused so many people to miss out on the joy of starting a family, of being married. And so hopefully in some ways it'll also encourage people to make commitments in their relationship that can be really life-giving.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that's the problem too with just, I mean, you know, the newer generations and my own generation.
It's, yeah.
it's there's also just so many distractions now to where they feel they can't just like choose one person. Hopefully the show does show the commitment side, although, yeah, you know, they try to push the more.
Good TV is good TV, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. No, but it's great. Well, we just appreciate you so much carrying your faith into these places and being really a positive person that can encourage people who are watching too, I think. And really, your story is great. You really did meet a guy and you guys really are happy, and that's amazing. That is so cool. And so I hope it encourages people. Hey, if you're at home and you want a great read, it's called The Road to Roses. Desiree Siegfried, thank you so much for joining us. I want to encourage you to get this book. Great story, and thank you for sharing this morning.
Yes. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you for joining us on Hour of Power today. We hope you found incredible hope and inspiration from this program. As the world gradually comes back to life after more than a year of being cocooned in quarantine, a fresh start is beckoning us to embrace a vibrant future, to dream big, and to look with anticipation to the great things the Lord wants to accomplish through us on the earth.
As always, this is the cry of our hearts here at Hour of Power. We've been humbled as God has sustained us through what was surely the most challenging season in recent history. And now we're ready to forge ahead even with greater gusto.
For the past 5 decades, whether on mountaintops or in valleys, your support and prayers have loved us back to life. And today, we're ready to share Jesus' good news with millions more. However, we need your help to make it happen in the midst of our summer slump.
We're trusting the Lord to uphold us so we can take the transforming power of the gospel to new generations. And we're joyfully giving thanks for your role in our story. In fact, you are the heart behind our July special offers.
Call, write, or go online to request our beautiful butterfly sun catcher. Featuring an antique copper metal frame, your sun catcher is suspended from a decorative chain and comes with a suction cup for easy display. A hand-painted finish creates a gleaming stained glass effect and will be a vibrant addition to your window or patio. We're asking for your gift of $25 or more. For your generous gift of $40 or more, we'll send you the butterfly sun catcher and the Today I Choose Joy canvas banner and prayer card. Perfect for display in your home or office, this decorative banner is a meaningful reminder to live each day with joy, and the matching frameable card provides a comforting prayer of encouragement. Call, write, or go online to request the butterfly sun catcher for your gift of $25 or more, or for your gift of $40 or more, we'll include the Today I Choose Joy canvas banner and prayer card.
Hannah and I are incredibly grateful for the way you uphold us. Your financial support provides the foundation we need to continue reaching friends all around the world. So thank you. We're praying for you. And remember, as always, God loves you, and so do we.
Welcome, church family. Today, let's celebrate being Americans by celebrating our love for Jesus.
Whenever I am weak, my hope, everything I need, is more than enough for me. Jesus is my peace, shelter from the storm. He's all my heart is longing for, the one that I adore. Jesus is. It's always
Well, whoever you are, would you stand with me? Hold your hands like this as a way of receiving from the Lord. We're going to say this together. I am not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. Thanks. You can be seated. We're going to spend the next month talking about training our speech. As strange as that sounds, we're going to talk about the power of words, how words move mountains and light forests on fire, how words ruin lives and save lives, and how, as a disciple, we learn that our marriages, our parenting, our friendships, our work, so much of it revolves around the kind of words that we're saying. And today we'll begin with Moses. Moses, of course, one of the most important figures in the Bible. His life is broken up into 3 40-year sections. Many of us, especially if you like Charlton Heston, know the whole thing. But Moses leads an amazing life. Towards the end of his life in the book of Numbers, as the stiff-necked people that he's leading out of slavery are drawing closer to the promised land, there's so many cases in which they try to take over Moses' leadership seat or try to kill Moses or exile him. And you see this frustration he has with these people, miracle after miracle, and they just never seem to trust Moses. And so there's this one scene finally where they're thirsty, and God tells Moses, hit the rock with your staff and water will come out. And so he does so, and this water comes out of this rock. It's a great miracle. Everybody drinks from the fresh water, and their livestock drinks from the water. Many of us already know this old story. But then there's a second rock story that ends up being punitive for Moses. It's the reason he can't go into the promised land. Later in the story, they're thirsty again. And God says to Moses, speak to the rock. So last time he says, hit the rock. This time I want you to speak to the rock and water will come out. And what does Moses do? He hits the rock twice, actually. The first time he hits the rock, and you kind of wonder, God said speak to the rock, but he hits the rock and nothing comes out. And then he hits the rock a second time. And actually, according to God's grace, water comes out and the livestock is fed and everybody drinks from it. But this is the straw that breaks the camel's back. This is the too far for God, where God finally says to Moses, you can't enter the promised land. And you wonder, what is the big deal that because Moses struck the rock instead of speaking to the rock, why would that be such a huge deal that God says you have to die never entering the promised land? You can only look over it. You're never going to go in. And actually, this is a favorite question that rabbis have loved to talk about and debate. There's lots of old writings on this that go on pages and pages. But my favorite and one of the most broadly accepted is this. God was teaching not only Moses, but the Hebrew people the power of speaking. That, yeah, you can strike a rock and water will come out, but you can also speak to a rock and water will come out. And that's something that an ancient people in the Bronze Age don't always understand. God wanted the people of the Promised Land to be a people who understood that the power of words is greater than the power of sticks. A people that understood that in fact, words are the things that made sticks. And that behind every great force is a great idea. And to articulate a great idea, you need some words. Sticks were made with words. And in fact, before it was even written in the New Testament, many great philosophers talked a great deal about the power of the word in the advent or creation of everything that's natural and ordinary in life. And the word that they often use is a word, logos. Now, I know 100% I just made Irene cringe. Irene, who speaks Greek, would say, it's logos. logos. But in the Koine, in ancient Greek, it's logos. They probably said it a different way. I don't really know, Irene. Logos or logos, whatever you want to say. It's the word for word. There's different words for word in Greeks, but logos, logos, is a big one. In the classical era, Heraclitus and others talked about how they believed that it was the basis of all knowledge, the word, that written word or spoken word. And in fact, anytime we talk about the science of something or the knowledge of something or the study of something, what do? You always add ology to the end of it, right? Logos. You add biologos is the word of life. Biologos, biology. And I could do that all day, couldn't I? So underneath the science of everything is this idea of logos. And the Stoics actually and others for a long time said, it seems like under everything that exists and that we can see and touch, there's a logos. There's an idea, a creator, a maker, a speaker, or a thinker. Logos has this idea of reason, ration. It's more than just a word. It's almost like we would think today in the modern era, coding for software, that underneath all of the things that you see on your computer screen are a bunch of words, a bunch of coding that makes something real. But underneath it is all this gibberish you don't understand. It's obvious, isn't it, that there's something special about words. And in fact, when you live in the natural world and you have a lot of life around animals, it's one of the main things you notice that makes us different than animals. Even animals wear clothes, right? But the one thing they don't do, they do all the things we do. They go to the bathroom and they eat and they mate and they move around and they use tools, even many of them. But the one thing they don't do is they don't use words. And in fact, when you begin to domesticate an animal, when a wolf goes from being a wild beast that travels in packs, that devours and mates constantly, to becoming your pet wolf, it almost becomes more human. And I kind of think it's because it understands your words. Barnaby, sit. I just came up with Barnaby, I don't know. That's a perfect name for a wolf. When you have an animal and you begin to speak to the animal and the animal understands what you're saying, it almost feels more alive, like it has a soul in a way that it didn't when it was just an animal. And so there's something in the ancient world, and we even carry it today, that we say there's something about words that makes something godly. And in fact, this is what the Bible even says, is that in the beginning was words. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In Genesis, it says over and over that God said, God said, God said, God said, let it be so, let it be so. And these things began to, you know, exist, and not just exist, but exist with intention and with reason. And even under a microscope, you can see that things do stuff in the same way that software would do stuff according to its code. Scientifically, you can observe within physics and biology and other places that things are doing things according to an undergirding code, that there's something guiding it all. And this is not something we've discovered today. It's something that smart people have known for a long time, that there is a word under everything. There's an idea, there's a coding or something that's guiding everything. We all know it. We all know this power of words. That's why we're so superstitious about words. I actually believe in superstition, by the way. Do you know that? I think that a lot of the superstitious stuff that has survived today is still around because it has a practical purpose. I can think of a few examples, but I mean, there's a reason why it's bad luck to walk under a ladder. It's because more than one painter has broken his jaw falling off a ladder from some dummy that walked under it, right? Or there's a reason why it's bad luck to open an umbrella inside, because more than one Parisian shopkeeper has slipped on droplets of water on his new tile floor. So these superstitions that emerge, some of them are ridiculous, but I kind of have a feeling that the superstitions that don't do anything go away, but the superstitions that have sort of a practical reason kind of seem to stick around. And we have this with words. If I am with my friends watching a Dodger game and they are Dodger fans and it is the seventh inning and Clayton Kershaw is pitching a no-hitter and I say, oh, Clayton Kershaw is pitching a no-hitter, every single guy in that room will look at me like, I have to leave. I have to leave right now. And by the way, you never get to come back and we will not forgive you. Because there's a superstition that if I, Bobby Schuller, am in Costa Mesa watching on television 100 miles away from Clayton Kershaw, who can't hear me, but I happen to say that he's hitting a no-hitter, something in the universe will happen that will cause Clayton Kershaw to throw something that becomes a hit. Like, somehow... In show business, you better not tell someone good luck. What do you say, choir?
Break a leg.
You say break a leg. Break a leg? Go break your leg. The worst thing in your body you could probably break. Your leg bone. Ouch. Exactly. So anyway, my point is this. All of us, even if you're an atheist, agnostic, you know there was a study that would pay atheists, like full-blown atheists, $5 to sign on a contract that they would sell their soul to the devil. And it even says on the bottom of the contract, this is a non-binding contract and not real. No atheist would sign that contract. Like, very small percentage would sign it. It's $5. If you don't believe in any of this stuff, why not just sign it? Because it's terrible luck. Who's going to sign their soul away to Satan for $5, even if you're an atheist? Not I. Not I. You never know. At that point, you're pretty sure you're an atheist. You're like 99%. You know what I'm saying? So James is writing to the people in a very Jewish way. James the Just, who's the author of the book of James, who is the biological brother of Jesus. He says this. He's a great leader in the church. And by the way, this is a sermon. A lot of people don't know, a lot of scholars believe this is actually a sermon that was written down. So it's the only, I think the only epistle in the Bible that was a sermon and wasn't just, you know, written down to be sent. He says, we all stumble in many ways. Listen to this promise. This is still the word of God. Anyone who is never at fault in what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. Think about that for a second. That's a pretty bold promise. When we put bits in, so first, you know, James is saying like, we'll get it. When you put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. So just pause for a second. Everybody, I feel like in the word, a lot of times it feels like if you've got all this bad stuff inside of you, you can't help it, but bad stuff is going to come out. Maybe there is some stuff in the scripture that appeals to that. But James is inverting that principle. He's saying, even if you got a bunch of bad stuff, wild stuff inside of your body, like a wild horse, if you put bits in a horse's mouth, then now you can direct your whole life. It's like inverts it. Like if you can control what you say, that will control your whole body. Think about this for a minute. If that's true, if what I say begins to have an impact on how I feel, what I say has an impact on how I act in life, the same way that a bit in a horse's mouth would, then when I feel embarrassed and declare to everyone, I'm such an idiot, which is something I do sometimes. I'm so stupid. God, I'm so stupid. What's that doing for me? Or when I just say, oh man, I am so poor. Or when I say, oh man, my job is terrible. Or, and I know I harp on this a lot, I am such a sinner. I'm such a sinner. Let me pause there with the sinner thing again, just in case it's your first time in church. You know, I think it's a really hard case to make, reading especially Paul's writings, to declare as a Christian, I'm a sinner. You declare I'm a sinner in your baptism or in your conversion, as you would, you know, declaring that you're guilty of something. But once, it's like a criminal who has been declared not guilty going around saying, I'm guilty, I'm guilty. And Paul seems to be teaching the church to declare not that I'm a sinner, but that I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Paul never writes to the sinners in the church of Corinth or to the sinners in the church of Ephesus. He writes to the saints. So you're not, it's not that people are perfect, and even he would say, like, I'm almost perfect. I think he says that at one time, but even all of that is just rubbish compared to God's grace in my life. Paul is talking about, and not even action, but that you have been made into an entirely new creation. And I believe, and I would, it would be interesting to do a larger study on this, that it's more, you know, I don't get my socks in a twist when Christians say I'm a sinner. I mean, I think we have some liturgies and stuff that have it. I just don't know if it's helping. I don't know if saying I'm a loser or I'm stupid or I'm a sinner is going to make you smarter, more successful, or less sinful. Humility can, but I think actually declaring I have victory, declaring I'm growing, declaring God's healing me, declaring I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, declaring that I've been saved, declaring that I've been rescued, declaring that the best days are ahead of me, I think that helps. I think that makes a difference. Just chew on it. Just think about it. But think about how, like the bit in the horse's mouth, the words that we use can actually begin to change our lives. In the same way, all those negative things can keep you in a kind of negative spiral. I think that even saying stuff like, I'm lucky, but just talking about good things that's happening in your life, I think can begin to kind of bring you out of a rut sometimes. So maybe it actually is true that although we want to change on the inside, sometimes that change comes with changing the way we speak. James goes on to say, or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they're steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Again, in the same way that the bridle guides the horse, the rudder guides the ship. You have these gigantic, beautiful ships with all this rigging, weight, cargo, wind, tides, and yet you have this tiny, invisible thing, this rudder under the water that really guides the whole deal. I'm always so amazed. I love to go to the mouth of the harbor in Newport and just have a cup of coffee and think and pray, and I'm always so amazed when you see a sailboat tacking into the wind. You know what that means? A sailboat can go straight into the wind by zigzagging. And so these hardcore sailors, you know, in Newport, they don't want to turn their little motor on because they want to brag. And they probably want to show off their boat to everybody because it's beautiful boats. But you see them and you think, are they even going anywhere? Because it kind of looks like they're just kind of going back and forth. But even though they're going slower than a walking pace, you see them and they exit the harbor just kind of doing this. If they didn't have a rudder, there's no way they could do that. So the wind pushes against them, pushing force against the rudder, which propels the boat forward. In fact, the only thing that would keep that boat from not going in that direction would be no wind. And many times this is true in our lives. Marcus Aurelius said that we want to be like fire, where we thrive on obstacles. And if there's no more obstacles left, we're not moving forward anymore. In the same way that the ship doesn't move forward anymore if there's no wind, but the thing that guides it is the words. Maybe you're going through something right now. You're just being pummeled by wind and tides. Those things can actually be power for you if you got your rudder right, if you control your words, if you're using the right kind of words. Stop saying the bad stuff, start saying the good stuff. And it's training like any other skill. And then finally he says, James, likewise the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue is also a fire, a world of evil among the evil parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and it is itself set on fire by hell. I almost picture the imagery of like spit, that the little droplets of spit that come out are almost like when you're talking, especially when you have contempt or deception, that can be like little sparks coming out of your mouth. And then it's just being like reckless, it's like smoking a cigarette, you know, at the gas station, or having a cigar while walking through, you know, wooded brush that's all dry. It's just so reckless and foolish that it's so easy to just destroy everything. You don't think words can destroy your life? You need to call your attorney. He'll let you know. You don't think words can destroy your life? Next time your wife is exhausted and she just put the kids down, tell her to try harder. Words can easily destroy anybody's life. Doesn't matter how powerful you are. I can think of a list of 10 words at least I could say right now without context at all, and if I said them, the ministry would be over. Isn't that unbelievable? I mean, I really can. I wouldn't say them, because if I said them, it would validate some dark thing. But there are words that you can say without a sentence even that can ruin your life. There are these things you just don't say. And then James goes on to say, all kinds of animals and birds and reptiles and sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind, but no human being can tame the tongue. It's a restless evil full of deadly poison. So he's wanting you to be weary of words and almost at fear with the deadly power as you would teaching a child to light a fire. Like, be careful. He goes on to say, with the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. You know what he's saying? If half the time you're praising God and saying positive things, and the other half the time you're deceiving, cursing, putting people down, people will be insulted by your good words because they know it's fake. You're either salt water or you're fresh water. If in public, if to your friend's face you're saying good things and then you're saying bad things about someone else who's not there, if your friend has any wisdom at all, they will know that once you leave, you know, you're going to be saying bad things about them. And that's kind of, yeah, you get it. All right, words are dangerous. So just hear me out, guys. We're going to spend the next 3 weeks talking about the power of words, how words can change your life. But just, if you don't give me a second chance next week to preach the second part of the sermon, I want you to do something for me. I want you to understand that what the Word is teaching us here is that the words that we speak aren't necessarily a reflection of what's inside, although they can be, but rather that the words we speak are our decision for who we want to become. What we choose to say out loud, we are almost casting a vision for our lives. That what we say out loud over time, over a long enough time, will begin to change what's within. If there's a lot of darkness and negativity on the inside, but you choose to become more positive in the words that you're saying, I believe that you'll begin to feel more positive in your life. There are many ways that this rolls out, but I want to promise you that the word of God is true here, that like a bit in a horse's mouth, like a rudder on a sailing ship, that what you begin to speak in your marriage, in your friendships, in your career, in your walk with God, in your prayer life will make a difference. Amen. When I pray, I want to pray out loud. You know why? Because Satan can't read my mind. I want him to hear the things I'm saying to the Lord. I want him to know what I believe. I want him to hear the screeching name of Jesus. That's what it is for a demon or for the enemy. It is like, my mom said when I was a kid once, she said, and I never forgot it, if you ever feel like there's a dark presence, just start praising Jesus because he hates hearing the name of Jesus worship. I can't tell you how many times as a grown man, you know, who thinks he's tough and all that stuff, and it's 3:00 in the morning and I'm feeling scared. You just go, you know, you just sing. I just sing. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word. And if it doesn't work, Haven, you got to turn it up. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. Right? You just feel it go away because you're choosing that what you say out loud is going to change the space around me and it's going to change me. You can choose what to say and what not to say. You can do that. And if it's true that what you say changes your life, you can choose where your life is going to go by changing how you're going to speak. Amen. Thank you. Amen. So don't use foolish words. Don't throw words around carelessly. Don't deceive. Don't use trickery in your language. Don't ever have contempt for people. Just respect everybody. Thank people for what they're doing in your life. Say it out loud to them or write it down on a card for them. Pray for people. When people are going through a tough time and they're having a rough day, ask them if you can pray for them. If you feel awkward praying for people, you're the right person to pray for people because you'll do it in a way that doesn't make people feel weird. It'll be meaningful for them. So pray for people, take a leap, and encourage people most of all. Just encourage them, and you'll find that you yourself are feeling a little encouraged too. Lord, we love you, and we thank you for giving us this amazing gift of words, words that are spoken, words that are written, words that are memorized. We pray that you would sanctify our words. Let them be words that bring life and not death. Let them be words of wisdom and not folly. Let them be words of goodness and not evil. Let us, God, to always speak in the right way to the people we love and even to the people we don't love. Help us, God, to understand the power of the creative and destructive power of words. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, friend. Have you subscribed to our channel yet? If not, then I hope you will. Our Power is filled with uplifting content to nourish your spirit and help you grow closer to Jesus. We've created this channel to remind you that no matter who you are or what you've done, God loves you, and so do we.